All right, 7 o'clock, we'll get going. Like to welcome everybody to tonight's meeting, and if you please stand, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by a moment of silent reflection.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. Mrs. Roberts, please call the roll.
Mr. Hoffman.
Here.
Mrs. John.
Here.
Mr. Smeltzer.
Here. I'd like to note that we have two board members unavailable tonight, so we're a little bit short-staffed tonight, but we'll be all right. All right. Hopefully you've had a chance to look at the minutes from last meeting. Any questions, comments, additions, corrections? If not, I need a motion to approve. Moved by Mr. Hoffman. Need a second?
Second.
Second by Mrs. Johns. Mrs. Roberts?
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Mr.
Smeltzer? Yes. Motion passes. 1.6 is adjustments to the agenda.
Do have a couple of adjustments. First, 6.4, I believe we need to table that until the November 6th meeting due to Mr. Myers and Ms. Conrad Zangmeister being ill this evening. We would not have appropriate number of votes to vote on 6.4, so I would recommend we table that until November 6th. And then 6.5 is an agenda item to approve some volunteers, and this is what happens when Christy's out of town and I'm in charge of the agenda. Only had one volunteer to start the day, added some as the day went on, and then forgot to go back and change the wording on 6.5. So that should just read a motion to approve volunteers as presented. And we have a list of several volunteers there. So just want to make that slight adjustment just in the wording of the motion.
Okay. All right. Questions, comments? Okay.
Need a motion.
I'm sorry. Need a motion to approve those adjustments?
So moved.
Moved by Mrs. Johns. I will second. Mrs. Roberts?
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Mr. Smeltzer?
Yes.
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Motion passes. That moves into number two, information discussion, superintendent updates. Mr. Belleville.
All right. Thank you. I'm going to keep my comments fairly short this evening. We have a couple presentations and have our principals presenting tonight as well, so want to give them as much time as possible, but do want to address a few things. In our agenda items this evening, there's a couple of workshops and conferences. Just want to again stress it's nice to see our staff members able to get back out and getting to professional development conferences. We appreciate them taking time away from families in a lot of cases for travel, or if it's an overnight trip or something like that, their willingness to do that so that they can provide for our students. And so would recommend we approve that. Also have a lot of personal service contracts, coaches, volunteers, as we head into the winter season. Want to just stress the importance and role that our coaches, our group leaders, whether it's organizations or clubs, staff members that serve as leaders for those groups. We're so blessed and so lucky to have people that are willing to sacrifice family time to serve students here in an extra capacity, and all they do for our kids. It is a true blessing to have people that not only are willing to do it, but just high character, high skill level, and we see it time and time again, our group's performing at a very high level, and it's because of the leadership of our coaches, our advisors, and volunteers. So just want to point that out, that we are appreciative of all those people. Also want to point out, and it's kind of a conjunction or kind of a duo type of thing, Fairfield County Fair was last week. It really was just an incredible event for Fairfield Union. We had a lot of students from top to bottom, K through 12, showing animals involved in the fair in various ways, different projects, and just had tremendous success across the board from our students, staff members there volunteering, and kind of steal from Mr. McPhail, and I mean, I like this hurts to say this, but because his head's going to get really big, but to steal from him, the common theme at the high school is the triple A plus one, and we've talked about that for the last year and a half. I'm going to steal a little bit from him and that motto of triple A plus one, but the district level arts be a little bit different. It's, you know, academics, arts, athletics, and our plus one is agriculture. And we are hitting on all cylinders in all four phases right now. And tonight, as you hear the presentations coming from the various stakeholders here, Mr. DeStadio is going to report on our academic report card. The principals will report on aspects of their buildings that cover academics, the arts, athletics. We have Mr. Baker here with our forestry team that just performed incredibly well, as well as officers from our FFA group. Seeing our band at the fair last week, I mean, it is you're just so proud of the hard work and effort that has gone into excelling at a very, very high level. And like I said, just kind of stealing from Mr. McPhail those four A's, when it's all coming together like it is right now, great things are happening. And it is a true blessing to be a part of it and kind of be able to stand back and watch it happen. And just so thankful for our students, our staff members, our community for the hard work and effort that has gone into building something truly special here. So excited to hear the updates and talk about the great things that are happening in all of our buildings and across the district. So that's all I have for this evening, and I'm going to really sit back and listen and kind of be a proud proud papa to all this tonight. So.
Mrs. Roberts.
All right, so just a few things, agenda items for this evening. First, Mr. Bevel mentioned it, but I did want to mention within the workshops and conferences, one, an apology, there is a workshop for Amy Noland and myself that has already happened. Some of this sometimes depending on what's going on out there in the environment. We got wind of some things that were happening in the school finance workshop on October 5th, kind of jumped on the day before, wanted to make sure, and it actually found out a lot from that meeting, so really happy we were able to join, but I did want to apologize because that obviously fell before this board meeting. And then the second is a meeting that is happening tomorrow. Both of these we're attending virtually, so we're actually in the office but attending virtually, but the one tomorrow has quite a bit of OFCC and capital project planning. A whole whole session on levies, which, you know, future at some point, just to kind of know what all the changes going on. There's some good information that's starting to pop up in some of these. So wanted to apologize because I know one has happened and then one's tomorrow, but sometimes with the environment out there, depending on what's happening, we try to jump on some of these. So wanted to bring that up. And then the other thing that I will be going through this evening are just our financial and insurance reports from the month of September, so I can get to those when we get there, but I will keep things high level because we have not had a ton of change since last month, but I will bring up just kind of a few numbers. So that's it for me.
All right, thank you. All right, number three, recognition of visitors. I don't believe we had anybody sign up.
No one signed up.
Okay. We'll move into number four, reports and presentations. 4.1, first up is the Fairfield Union Forester Team and FFA officers.
I have Mr. Baker, want to kind of fill us in on what you guys have been up to, and do want to point out real quick, just want to say thank you to Mr. Baker. You know, we started out this year with two new staff members in the ag department, and Mr. Baker stepped forward and took on that challenge and took on a lot more leadership, and as you're getting ready to hear, we haven't missed a beat because of his leadership, hard work, as well as the hard work of Ms. Penrose and Mr. Brain, but really just wanted to highlight Mr. Baker's efforts to start this school year. So thank you.
Yeah,
appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. The two FFA officers we have here tonight, I'm going to let them kind of recap and review what we've been up to lately as far as the FFA goes. Got my forestry team here tonight. obviously super, super proud of our second state championship team that Fairfield Union has had here in recent years. It's one of those, I'm super, super proud of them. They worked really hard. I took 16 kids down to Nelsonville, and these four individuals are the top scoring individuals on the team, so that makes the official team for the forestry team. It's one of those things that they're kind of being tricked into learning at a high level. Through this competition, they get so involved in trying to do well and trying to beat the team up north, and which is, who's that? we got a friendly competition between us and Liberty. It seems like we're always at the top. So, but through that competition, you know, these guys are learning how to timber cruise, how to identify trees. We had a timber stand improvement part of it. What else did we do? Chainsaws. We did forestry tools. It's just an intense amount of information that, you know, these four individuals know just about as much as anybody else in the state. And from what I've found, that when you get that high-level information into these young people, it almost triggers them to kind of maybe take that to the next level. Got a student from a couple years ago that's studying forestry in Idaho right now that was on the state winning team a couple years ago. I've got another student that just graduated from West Virginia University, did 2 years of hawking, and then graduated from West Virginia, and now is a private consultant in forestry in Ohio. And that just, it really makes me proud to see those guys doing so well. And, you know, I think every year there's just another kid or two that ends up choosing this as their career path because of these career development events. So I want to thank the board for the continued support. I know I always send Mr. Belleville and Mr. McPhail a message of how we did every year, and it's kind of neat to see the excitement, the messages that come back from these guys, and it just, not only are my kids all in, but the school's all in backing us, so I appreciate that.
You want to introduce them?
Oh, well, I didn't know how you guys were going to do things, but right here we have Cole Rowley. 3 years?
3 years.
3 years. So now Cole, I will probably still continue him call him one of my first four-year members on the forestry team next year, although he won't be able to participate on the state team. These individuals are done as far as the state level. That's just how the CD works. But since we don't compete this year in the forestry, they will be competing at nationals next year. So I'm gonna call Cole one of my first 4 year team members, even though he won't be competing at state. We've got Jace Shumway. Jace placed in the top 10 and worked really hard. It's his second year on the team. I could tell he wanted it when he found out the results. When we got the results that morning, we were working on the storage building and results came in and we looked at it, and he was pretty pumped. We got Mason Yerian here. Mason Yerian placed third in the state of Ohio out of 247 individuals. I think there was 247. Nice. So he was third overall. Pretty impressive. Puts a lot of time and effort in. I think pretty much the majority of the team considered him the team leader as far as knowledge, and it's pretty impressive. Katie Fox down here, first year competing. Sent Katie to forestry camp this past summer, and I think she's kind of fallen in love with the natural resources and forestry through this, and just worked so hard. You know, if there was any free time at the end of my class, I'd have her in class this year, and if there's any free time, she was opening up that forestry book and all that stuff. Yeah.
I applied today to college for environmental science and forest management.
That's awesome.
Nice.
Yep, that's awesome. So it just makes me so happy to see that kind of stuff in these young people, and I think it was through the forestry camp, natural resources class last year, forestry this year. It just kind of instills that in these kids. So, yeah.
What about your two officers, John?
Okay. Do you want to finish up with the forestry, or do you want these guys to go ahead and?
Yeah, I guess I will finish up the forestry.
Okay.
First. All right. We just have some certificates here for the forestry team. It is Fairfield Union Local School District hats off to, and it says for your positive contribution to the Fairfield Union Local District for Mason Yerian for third place at State Forestry Competition.
Congratulations, guys.
Now, Judd, yeah.
Katie, if you need a letter of recommendation, make sure you let us know.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
At this point, I'll go ahead and introduce our two officers. We got a senior officer, reporter, Georgia Starner, and Leith Wolf here, junior reporting officer. They're going to talk about what we've been up to here this past fall in the FSA.
You can just stand up. Yep, be fine. It'll pick you up.
Good evening, everyone. Like Mr. Baker said, my name's Leith Wolf. I'm the junior reporter for the FFA team. Pretty much my job is, if George can't make it to any FFA meetings, I step up, then I become the reporter. Anything she needs, just like in the classroom, ag classroom, and just reporter duties, then I'm here to help. I play soccer. I'm in the marching band. Going to Fairfield Union. And,
I'm the senior reporter. I've been reporter 2 years now. We've been pretty active this little fall stretch, so excited to report on this.
Okay. So we're going to start off with the FFA chapter hosted two of the state officers on Wednesday, October 4th. They put together a workshop for all the ag classes. I was able to attend it 3 times. It was a very good workshop. I enjoyed it quite a lot. We also had pizza for them for lunch that the officer team all got to go talk to them and thank them for coming. It was a good event. I really did quite enjoy it.
While on fair break, many of the Fairfield Union FFA members were hard at work taking care of their fair projects. We had many species and summer projects entered into the fair. The chapter could not be more proud of the hard work and dedication of their members. This week consisted of many bittersweet moments as the students watched their hard work pay off in the show ring, having many chapter members do well, placing first in a lot of their classes. The 4-H and FFA community could not be more proud of what these kids have accomplished. There are some hard goodbyes but at the end, but reflecting back, it's so nice to look at all of the growth that you've made, like maturing and like the connections you made along the way. I mean, I'm close with so many more people than I would be if it wasn't for FFA, and all the hard work pays off at the end, and we couldn't be more proud of our community and the chapter and all their accomplishments this week.
We also started our annual FFA sale today, fundraising sale, selling meat, cheese, fruit, barbecue. So just if anyone wants some, reach out. Plenty of FFA
good
members
job.
ready to sell you some. Raise some money for our chapter. I think that's all we've got. Thank you.
All right. Thank you guys very much. I'm sorry, I should have had you guys shake hands with the other board members, so if you would like to please come shake their hands. And then finally, I would just like to personally say that, you know, congratulations on everything, and makes me really happy to hear all this FFA stuff, because I'm an alum of the FFA and a former treasurer and president of the FFA during my time. So I really love to hear about all this stuff. So thank you very much.
And if you guys want to slip out, perfectly understandable, you're more than welcome to stay and enjoy the rest of the meeting. But if you want to slip out, you're more than welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thanks.
Thank you
for being here.
See you guys.
Good job.
Thanks.
Good job. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having guys.
All right. We'll move on to 4.2. This is the report card update. Mr. DeStadio.
Yeah, so once again, I'd like to thank everybody for allowing me the opportunity really to just to brag. Once again, another stellar academic school year here at Fairfield Union Local Schools. Trying to condense the state report card and all the entries that go with that into a brief presentation can be a little bit challenging. So I will do my best to kind of highlight the main portions of what we do here at school, what we're looking at behind the scenes to kind of evaluate the programs and to make sure that from the curriculum standard, from the curriculum aspect, that we're doing our due diligence to make sure that the students here at Fairfield Union are getting the education that they deserve. I think it's very fitting that I go after the presentation of our groups here, because we've said this time and time again, and it's something that we truly believe. There is so much more to giving a student a well-rounded education than just a test score. I think the excitement and the success that you just heard about from our ag groups is a true testament to that. Obviously, when it comes to school, you know, curriculum is going to be a big component of it. Not the end-all, be-all, but it's definitely going to be something that, you know, from my position, that I like to kind of spend a lot of time to make sure we're doing our due diligence to provide the best educational opportunity we can for our kids. I will apologize now. I'm testing your eyesight tonight. The handouts that they gave you, the first one, to try to fit it on one page is a little bit small, but I promise I will send an updated electronic copy to you as well. But what we'll do is we'll kind of go ahead and start on the first handout for you. Over the past couple months, the information that comes out from the state will come out in a couple of different segments. And right around the end of May, beginning of June, one of the first pieces of information that we really anxiously await. So what you have there on your first handout is just a spreadsheet of the academic state testing performance that we did here in the district. It will cover 20 different tests from grades 3 all the way through high school. And the first thing that we do is when we get the data, you know, we start to kind of look broad picture and kind of see, you know, what are the first indications that are jumping out at us. So one of the first pieces of information that we love to do once we get our specific test scores back, we start by comparing our test scores to the state averages. And once again, for about the third or fourth year in a row, we are above the state average in all 20 tested areas. This is a true testament to the work that we're seeing in the classrooms with our teachers, with our students, and quite honestly, as we kind of go through the presentation tonight and talk about the success that we're having, this really is a community kind of feel and approach to it. You've heard us say before that it takes a village to raise a student, raise a child, and everything that we're seeing here in terms of the results on the report card, in terms of the curriculum achievements, really cannot be understated. We want to thank everybody who's a part of this community, from the parents, the students, the teachers, the administrators, and then those staff members that we don't typically recognize and think about when we're talking about test scores. You know, everybody from the secretaries to our bus transportation department, to our lunch workers and staff. You know, this is truly an approach that without everybody contributing in their own way to make sure that we have the best facilities possible and the best environments possible for our students, we wouldn't be seeing the results that we're seeing here tonight. So I want to say thank you to everybody in the district for all their contributions day in and day out. As you start to go through and break down the test data, you know, one of the next things that I like to look for is I look to see how did we compare from one year to the next. One of the metrics that I use kind of just as a standard for myself, you expect to see anywhere from a plus to a minus two in terms of overall movement from one year to the next. And as long as you're within that plus to minus two range, you're really on track. Within that plus to minus two statistic that we're using, you know, you're accounting for things that are a lot of times outside of the control of a teacher. You know, environments outside of the classroom, what students are going through at home, you know, things along those lines. So as we started to go through and really break down the data, 16 out of the 20 tested areas, we saw an increase from last year. If you start to look hard at the data, there were about 5 or 6 different areas where we increased anywhere from 10 to 20% in overall test scores and achievement rates. So not only are we comparing ourselves to the state and showing that we are excelling from the state averages, you know, the next thing we like to always do is we like to challenge ourselves and make sure that each year we're pushing a little bit more to make sure that we're getting the most out of the potential that we have in our students. And as the data is showing, there is plenty of positives to celebrate. Once again, 16 out of the 20 are up from last year's test scores, which up until that point were the highest in recent history for the district. So the first round of data that we come through is going to be our test score data. And I don't know if there's any questions about the breakdown there before we kind of move on and show how this will impact the overall state report card, which just came out last year. Okay. So as we remember, last year was the first year that the state moved from a letters-based report card where you received a grade in A through an F, kind of along the lines of what I think most of us experience in school in terms of a report card. And last year was the first year that they moved to a star rating system. The description that we received was kind of think of it like a Michelin star rating, and the more stars you get, you know, the better your performance. So this is year two of us working on the star report card system. There were some changes from last year's first year to the second year. And the reason I want to point that out is, you know, a lot of times as you're trying to go through, you hear a lot about the frustrations in terms of when the system is consistent, you can start to study what they're looking for and really kind of hone in and fine-tune to make sure we are addressing the areas that we need to address. When there's little changes from year to year, you know, it can be very frustrating, but one of the things that we preach from the district level to the building level down to the classroom level is controlling the controllables. You know, we're going to make sure that we're never going to be a slave to report cards. We're going to make sure that we always do our due diligence, but at the same time, we're always going to make sure that we're doing what we feel is in the best interest of students. And if it's something that doesn't necessarily reflect on the report card, we'll deal with that and we'll tweak it as we go. So when it comes to the state test scores, the overall report card this year, we once again earned a 4-star rating out of 5 possible stars. You can, on the overall rating, receive half stars. So we did not receive a 4.5 or a 3.5. We did receive a 4 out of 5. But what we did was, when we started to look at all the schools in the county, we were actually second in the county in terms of overall number of stars. When you start to break down where that 4-star rating comes from, there's 5 components or subcategories on the report card that also have their individual 1 through 5-star rating. When we take those subcategories and add up the individual star components, that is what determined that we were a 4-star school district again this year. Of the subgroups, we actually received 21 individual stars, which once again was second in the county. So we're thinking Mid-State League and even some of the larger OCC schools nearby. Once again, we received the second highest number of overall stars at 21 stars. Now, when you start to look at some of the frustrations with the report card, one of the school districts has actually scored a 4.5 overall rating, so a 0.5 star higher than what we achieved, actually only earned 20 individual stars on the subcategories. Once again, we earned 21. So as you're still going through and we're learning about this report card and looking at the nuances of you know, how they're weighing things, what we're being evaluated on, once again, we're incredibly proud of the fact that we earned 21 stars, and we're more proud of that 4-star rating than really anything else. So I want to point out, once again, one of those little nuances, a little bit of a frustration point, but once again, we're going to control the controllables and make sure we're focusing on what's in the best interest of kids. So as you start to go through the report card, the first category is achievement. Once again, we earned 4 out of 5 stars in the achievement category. And the achievement category is, I think, what people historically remember about a state report card. When we give those 20 different state tests from third grade all the way through high school, there's a performance index, or in other words, every single student who takes a test earns an individual rating of a 1 through a 5. Depending on how they score on the individual test, the state then assigns points towards our performance index, and generally speaking, the higher you score on a test, the more points you get to contribute towards your school's overall final total. So when you look at simply the scores of our students in the overall performance index, we actually score in the top 30% of all schools, school districts in the state of Ohio. So once again, when you are scoring better than 70% of the schools in the state, that's a huge indicator that in terms of the academics and the state testing, we are excelling across the board. Obviously, room to improve if you really start to drill down and look for specifics, but we want to celebrate where we need to celebrate. So once again, in the top 30% of all scores across the state of Ohio on this past year's spring state exams. Now, when you go to do the calculations of where that 4-star rating comes from, this is where it becomes a little bit of a you control what you can control. Even though this is an overall percentage that dictates your final rating, it's not a percentage out of 100. So each year, once you calculate the total number of points that you've earned on your state report card from your students' data, that is going to be your numerator in your fraction. And the denominator that they're comparing us to is actually the top 2% of school districts in the state. So when you start to think about that, you know, a lot of people make the argument that you're kind of comparing apples to oranges. You're looking at different size schools, different demographics, different socioeconomic expectations and standards. And once again, when we take our earned total points and compare them against the top 2% in the state, it put us right around an 82% average. If we were to just take our raw data and put it over 100, as you would see in a typical percentage, we're right around 90%, which would probably bump us up to at least, you know, another kind of half rating system there. So in terms of achievement, once again, top 30% in the state of Ohio, 16 out of the 20 areas increased from last year, and once again, all 20 tested areas are above the state average when it comes to the state test in the spring. So great work being done across the district. Huge shout out to our teachers, our students, our parents, you know, everybody involved, because once again, that is something that there's a lot of stress on the students to make sure they're performing well. And year in and year out, our students and our staff kind of answer the call, and they really showcase, you know, what they've learned and how much growth they've shown in 1 year on those state exams. The second indicator that contributes to your overall 4-star rating is progress. So progress is really what it sounds like. When we look at all students, we want to make sure that all students, regardless if you're a gifted student, you know, somebody who has maybe some more cognitive needs in the classroom, somebody that's a career pathway student, someone that's going to go to a 2 or 4-year university, we want to meet kids where they're at, and we want to make sure that every single student can grow to really fulfill the most potential that is possible in one school year. So when we look at progress, once again, on this individual category, we received 4 out of 5 stars, which means we are exceeding the state minimum or the state average. And what they're really looking at here is a component that a lot of us have heard about over the years called value added. Value added is a metric that comes from the state that determines where a student starts a year and therefore theoretically where we should be able to grow them to in one school year. Lot of controversy around the formula itself. Actually invented through a farming community to increase the head of cattle. So when you start to look at, okay, making sure the head of cattle increase versus growing a human being's, you know, needs and wants in a classroom, there's a lot of confusion about does that really kind of cross over to be a fair metric. But when we come down to the data, when you look at our value added data, we actually score in the top 15% in the state of Ohio. So once again, when we take our students and we meet them where they are, we are in the top 50%, we're 85% better than every other school in the state of Ohio to make sure that we grow our kids and make sure that they're hopefully achieving their fullest potential possible. When it comes to value added, however, there's one of those little gotchas. So because we're such a high performing district and our test scores are so high, there's less room to grow. So a lot of times you kind of feel like you're kind of, you know, a little bit handicapped and kind of hamstringing yourself, where when there's less room to grow, sometimes the value added measures don't reflect what the true achievement was on the test scores. So the example that I like to use is, if you have a student that earns a B in a class, you know, obviously we're gonna try to grow them to an A. But if I can get a student to go from B to an A, there's kind of one unit of growth there. A student who maybe enters the class with an F average and works their tail off and can move themselves to a C, has 2 units of growth. So the comparison is not necessarily what level of academic achievements did they reach, how much growth, how much progress was there in between. So while the student who went from an F to a C increased by 2 units, and the student that went from a B to an A only increased by 1, I think a lot of people would say, well, obviously the person who earned an A maybe has earned a higher achievement. But in terms of this measure on the report card, they're looking at overall progress from where did we start to where did we go. So it's one of those things where by doing so incredibly well year after year on the achievement portion of the report card, there's less room to grow. So sometimes the overall star calculation can be a little bit misleading. So even though we only scored a 4 out of 5 stars, we were in the top 15% of making sure that our students grew from point A to a positive point B. So I think that's a very, very important statistic to point out there. The third area is gap closing. Gap closing really kind of goes hand in hand with progress. As students progress through and increase their knowledge throughout a school year, you know, the gap should be closed from what they don't know to what they do know. And in terms of gap closing, prior to report that we did receive 5 stars across the district there. The 3 areas that we're looking for in terms of gap closing is English, math, and graduation rate. So when it comes down to our gap closing measures, they look at specific subgroups to make sure that nobody is being left behind. When it comes to subgroups at Fairfield Union, we don't have a ton of different subgroups. So one of the main subgroups that they focus on is our gifted indicators, our gifted students, those students who have taken certain state level exams and they've scored high enough to say that they are placed in a category of gifted services. When it comes to the state of Ohio, you are required to screen for gifted services, but you're not required to actually provide gifted services to your students. And depending on which school district you may find yourself in, some school districts just don't have the resources available. We do, however, make sure that we're not just screening our students, we actually provide gifted services from about third grade all the way through senior year and graduation. I would like to really acknowledge the work from Mrs. Edie Schilling. Edie is our gifted and curriculum advisor here at the district office. Edie has done an amazing job over the years of really taking our gifted program and really kind of building it up to what it is now. So in terms of our gifted services, about 97% of the students in our district who were identified as gifted received gifted services. Not necessarily the measure you're going to see on the report card in terms of what is being contributed to our final grade. But when you look at just our gifted data by itself, once again, we are in the top 30% of the state in terms of our gifted identifications and gifted services. So what that really says is when we say that we care about every one of our students and we're going to meet every single one of our students where they are, we're going to let them to grow, that doesn't mean that means if you're a gifted student all the way down to somebody that needs some special services, we're going to tailor what we're doing in the classroom to make sure we meet the needs of kids, we meet them at their academic levels, and we grow them to their fullest potential. So in terms of gap closing, we were able to earn 5 stars, but when you start to look at some of the data that you go through, one of the areas where we had a little bit of a lower rating with the gifted services was in our identification rates. The state has a certain expectation for how many students, what percent of your population they would like to see identified. We've made a very conscious effort to make sure that we're not going to over-identify students just to hit an indicator. We're going to be fair to our students and make sure that if they earn those levels, we're going to provide gifted services to really grow them with some stretch and rigor in the classroom. But at the same time, we're not going to try to inflate or maybe put a student's best interest on the back burner just to make sure we hit some key numbers on a report card. So even with some of those low indicators because of how things are calculated, we were still able to, with all of our subgroups and the gap closing measure of making sure we took a student and we grew them from day one to the last day of school, 5-star rating, which is the highest in the state. The fourth category that goes to the overall rating is the graduation rate. Once again, the school year, we earned a 97% graduation rate, and that's really, so telling of what the high school administration is doing when it comes to a 4-year program. I think it's very, very easy to look at graduation rate and think, well, a kid walked across the stage and got a diploma. What it takes to get a kid from day one of freshman year to the last day of senior year is really, really impressive. There's 3 components that go into your graduation rate. So the first component that they look at, we need to make sure that a student meets all of their minimum credits for the state of Ohio. The state of Ohio says you need to have a minimum of 20 credits. We require our students to have 23. We're never gonna be okay with achieving the bare minimum. We wanna prepare our students to be successful in whatever field they choose to tackle after high school. Once they've achieved their 23 credits, which I think for most people kind of makes sense, did you pass your classes that you need to pass high school? The second component is going to be your competency. So in terms of the state exams, the algebra and English exams do count as you must pass the exam in order to earn your graduation diploma. The third part is going to be what they call the readiness seals for the state. A big catchphrase you heard over the past decade or so was, are our students college and career ready? Well, what does that mean? So what students actually have to earn over their 4 years of high school, they have to earn different seals that show they are either college or career ready. So for our college preparation students, they're going to be earning some other seals, maybe in some of the other state exams that they're taking. They can earn seals through honors, diplomas, AP courses, things of that nature. And for students that maybe are going to go kind of more of the workforce route, you know, they can earn COs through CTE programs and kind of hands-on training to show that whether I'm going to go to college after graduation or I'm going to enter the workforce, I am going to be able to be an active contributing member to society, have a good job so I can provide for my families, and then contribute to, hopefully, the next generation of Falcons here at Fairfield Union. One of the things that we've really focused on at the high school over the past 5 years or so, when a student enters high school, we want to put them on pathways to get them prepared for whatever their future holds. And for most students, it kind of goes down to one of three roads. You've got your traditional college prep classes and pathway for students that want to enter a 2 or 4 year university after high school. You've got your kind of middle pathway for students who maybe just aren't quite sure which route they want to go. Maybe looking at college, maybe entering the workforce. So you kind of have your general track there that exposes students to kind of both sides. CTE kind of hands-on working classes, and then your college pathways as well. And then your third route is going to be your CTE pathways, where we have three different pathways within our buildings, two in our ag department and one in our business department, that can earn students some college credits before they even leave high school to kind of give them a head start on their programs. And then we do have a large number of students that their junior year find their way either to the career centers or the workforce development centers here in Central Ohio to really get them prepared for some hands-on training so that when they graduate, they can hit the ground running. So all of those components go into what the high school is doing from day one of freshman year to the very last day of senior year and graduation. And once again, right at the top of the all the schools in the county with a 97% graduation rate over the past 5 years, which is absolutely phenomenal. Our last category is going to be the early literacy components. This is going to be where we are going to focus a lot of our attention this year. This was our category we received the fewest amount of stars. We received 3 stars here, but that does meet the state requirements. So when you're used to 4s and 5s, you know, when you kind of get that 3, it kind of jumps out at you. What we're working on right now is really aligning both buildings to make sure that students across both Pleasantville and Bremen Elementaries are receiving the same high-quality instruction. So some of the things that we're working on to ensure that our early literacy rates will improve for next year. You've heard the term vertical alignment. Right now, we are working at the elementaries to vertically align and make sure that the flow of information from 1 year to the next is sequential and builds on itself. So a student going from 1st to 2nd to 3rd grade continues to close the gap and progress through the curriculum. One of the ways we're doing that is we're really using the Wilson Reading Program to use as our early literacy program. There's a lot of good techniques in there that, and when you break down the report card data in terms of reading fluency, reading comprehension, this program will basically allow our teachers to kind of hone in, and wherever a student is deficient, the program will kind of help to fill in those gaps, make sure the students learn those skills so that we can start to see the positive results on the test scores. The overall rating mainly comes from the 3rd grade reading guarantee. So the 3rd grade test that's given in the spring is a main component. The other components that go to the early literacy are gonna be what percentage of our students were promoted to 4th grade. And I am happy to say that 100% of our students were promoted. Nobody was retained based on their test scores. The test score component comes from the spring data. But any student who doesn't meet that has a couple of other opportunities throughout the school year to get some remediation, take the test again, and earn their credits. So when I say that 100% of our students were promoted to 4th grade and no one was retained, we didn't just push them through. Those students earned the qualifying scores throughout the school year. Might not have been on the spring test, which was the first component, but when you look at those other testing options that were available, they did earn the minimum requirement to move on. The third component that goes into early reading or early literacy category is we look at the progress of students from kindergarten through the end of 3rd grade. Once again, you meet students where they are. So when you have someone that comes into kindergarten, there's a vast range of ability levels there. You have some students that have gone to preschool, some that have never set foot inside of a school. You have some families who make it a point to really be able to read their kids at night. And there's some families that maybe just don't have the resources available to them to make sure that their students are kind of coming in on the same level playing field. So what we focus on there is meeting the students where they're at. And when you look at our data, if If a student is not on track, we've worked hard, and throughout the school year, you start to see those gaps closing. You maybe never get every single kid on the same level playing field, but with the progression and gap closing data, we're showing that we are taking our students where we meet them, and we are growing them from one year to the next. Then comes summer, where there's going to be a little bit of a slide back when students aren't in that structured environment, and then that process starts over again until we get to that third grade test in the spring, and hopefully the test scores continue to trend upward like we're showing. So Wilson Reading is really going to do a big part of what we're trying to do in the district this year to make sure we're filling in those gaps in terms of student skill sets so they can pass that state exam in the spring. The other big thing that we're using this year is a new tool that's made available to us from the state of Ohio called the Assessment Authoring System. Over the years, there's been a lot of questioning, I'll say in a polite way, from school districts to the state, asking for some practice tests. If we're going to test these kids on one day, and that's going to be such a huge component of our the factors if we're successful or not, they wanted to have some type of a practice system. So they've actually unveiled a new system this year called the Assessment Authoring System. They started to kind of unroll parts of it last year, and the fun part is that this year, at this point in the school year, we've actually got three times as many tests that have been given than all of last school year. At this point, we're over about 1,000 practice tests that have been given to students in grades 3 through high school, and the data that comes back from those tests is a mirror of what we're going to see on the state report card data. So while testing is not the end-all be-all, and we're not going to put all of our eggs in one basket in terms of how effective are we as a school district in terms of just test scores, we do want to practice the way we're going to play. So included in the curriculum, included in lesson plans, there's going to be formative and summative assessments that are built in to check and see how our students learning and achieving at certain points throughout the year. And we're really putting a big focus on trying to use the data that has been given to us by the state to assess, to give ourselves a true indication before the springtime comes of where do we expect our test scores to be. This is the first year, once again, that's a fully active system. So step one is just trying to use it as much as possible. And then over the next couple years, we'll look at the trend data, you know, from quarterly assessments, from short cycle assessments to help inform our teaching strategies, to help inform our practices, and make sure we're hitting the key components that we know we're gonna see on the spring testing cycle. A couple of other highlights from the testing world. We did have a record number of AP tests last year. We now have 5 different AP classes that we offer at the high school, and we had 116 students take advantage of that last year. The reason I'm pointing out that statistic for you, starting next year, there's going to be a 6 component to the report card that's going to look at college and career readiness. Mm-hmm. And one of the components there that we can start to prove that we are doing our students, you know, their due service to make sure they're ready, is we're looking to see, well, how many AP classes were offered, how many AP tests were given, what were ACT test scores. So there's going to be some more components that are coming down the road. We don't want to be completely caught off guard. So a lot of what we're doing this year is kind of looking to see what's coming down the pike. We're going to make sure we're not completely caught off guard. We're not totally sure how those scores are going to be calculated. So when they do start to factor into the overall star rating system, there is going to be a little bit of a learning curve and kind of see the first time back, you know, where did we score? What does the breakdown look like? But we're trying to be as proactive as possible. So when that next component does come, hopefully we can hit the ground running and then we can improve upon that for years to come. So last thing, we have the fall ACT administration tomorrow. This is an optional testing option for our students in grades 10 through 12, and we did have 19 different students that opted to sign up and challenge themselves and give themselves an opportunity to take the ACT this fall. And then in the spring, all juniors statewide are required to take the ACT. So 19 of them decided to dig a little bit deep in their pockets, pay the fee, and they're going to be taking the ACT tomorrow. So extremely excited to see how they score on those tests. There's any questions I can answer for you?
He wins, yep.
Please email me any questions, and like I said, I'll send you a digital copy of the data there so you can review it. And once again, anything I can help answer, please don't hesitate to do so.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Studio. Appreciate that. All right. We will move into administrator reports. And Flip a coin. Let's go Mrs. Tokars, please.
All right.
If you would, up here where Mr. DeStadio was, we'd appreciate that.
Okay. Well, good evening.
Good evening.
So I experienced my first fair week this past week. It was awesome. I don't think there's anything better than being a principal celebrity at the fair. Mr. Tokars might say otherwise. He couldn't take me anywhere in Canal. Now he can't take me anywhere in Fairfield County. That's okay. So building highlights for Pleasantville, we're so excited to announce that we are working to create voice and choice with our fourth grade students, and we're gonna be starting a fourth grade student council. Student council is an opportunity for our fourth grade leaders to take an active role in school-wide initiatives and community service projects. Student council members will meet at least once a month during their lunch and recess. While representing Pleasantville Elementary, these students will serve as role models among their peers, and they will demonstrate SOAR at all times. Also, we're so excited to announce that we had a wonderful breakfast club right before fair break, thanks to our PTO. On our first day alone, we had over 280 people attend. I was told that our parking lot was too small. That's accurate, but it was wonderful, and I so much enjoyed meeting so many of the community members. For our building focus, students at Pleasantville are soaring through our common spaces. SOAR stands for being safe, on task, accountable, and respectful. Throughout the week, adults in the building are showering our students, exhibiting these positive qualities with SOAR tickets. Students get to bring their ticket to the office. It's a big deal when they bring it in. Miss Mary and anybody in the office, me, whoever, cheers for the student that's dropping their ticket in. They get very excited to do that. Students anticipate Falcon Friday at the end of the week. We get the entire school's attention by playing an upbeat song across the all-call system and announcing that it's Falcon Friday. Then we take all the tickets in the jar and we choose a kindergarten student, first, second, third, and fourth grade, and we choose one student in each grade level from the SOAR jar to get an all-call shout-out and a special token of appreciation for being a leader in our school. Students get their picture taken, and it's a great way to end on a high note on Friday afternoon. In terms of professional development, speaking of the third grade reading guarantee, I'm so proud of our third and fourth grade teachers. They've been working diligently with the new Ohio Readiness Tool in the Ohio State Testing Portal. Those sample items and practice tests allow our students to view and answer test questions that are like those that could appear on the state tests. Teachers and parents may use related resources to help our students know what to expect. Also, we finished up a great district PD a few weeks ago, bringing the science of reading into comprehension and also learning how to use AI to support instruction. Upcoming events, we're gearing up for the Ohio State test in third grade for ELA. We're also getting ready to celebrate Red Ribbon Week. And of course, we have all of the Pleasantville fall fun, including our parade and our parties. And lastly, I just want to give a huge shout out to my staff for being team players, especially on difficult days. Each person in my building has embodied excellence in supporting and loving our students. Thank you.
I'm going to play dumb, or, well, you know, some people may say the otherwise, but Red Ribbon Day or Week?
Red Ribbon Week. Okay. So it's anti-drug week. And so we're doing spirit days, and this week the theme is Be Kind to My Mind. Be kind, Be kind to my mind. And so we have some fun spirit days planned Monday through Friday. So we're excited about that.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Mr. Knott.
All right, I'm talking fire trucks and field trips. One of my favorite things about Bremen is the partnership with the community. So kindergarten, first grade, working on community helpers. And so we went and visited the firehouse. Fire trucks came out. It's always, you can read about it and you can watch video clips and stuff, but the real life connection, trying on that stuff, seeing that hose with the water, that's what that sticks with them. And so we always are so appreciative of those partnerships. Our kindergarten went to the Van Buren farm. The pumpkins always come back bigger than they are. You know, they must get that pumpkin on that bus and bring it in. So it's always fun to help them get back on the bus at the end of the day with the pumpkins that they chose. But it was a great day weather-wise, and the kids were great, so it was a fun time. Second grade with the slate run, that is a really fun, like the kids come back and they are exhausted. And that's because it is so hands-on and they are moving that whole time. And so again, making those connections of what we're doing in the classroom, out in the community, in the area, so they can make that, you know, it sticks a little bit more when we're able to make those kinds of connections. Our book fair was a great success. A shout out to Mrs. LaCrone and all the parent volunteers. It was very smooth. And there were, hey, more books and less pens and light up things. So I was very pleased with that. I'll take that anytime. We are having our breakfast clubs this week, so that'll be Wednesday and Thursday. We break it up by the alphabet. I'm looking forward to that, talking with the families and things like that. Staff comes in, kind of helps serve. Our PTO does a nice job of kind of getting everything ready and rolling for that. Like Mrs. Tokar says, Red Ribbon Week, so we're talking crazy socks, we're talking fun hats, of course, costumes, and so you just roll with it. You just have a good week, and then the following week we will do state testing. And so it all kind of just balances out as we do, as you do what you need to do and things like that. You know, today I was actually sitting and listening to my paraprofessionals, my aides, working with the kids. They received some training from our coaches early in the year on the science of reading, how they can complement what the teachers are doing in the classroom. And it was top notch. And it was a lot at them very quickly, and they really have absorbed it. They've asked good questions, they've had follow-up, and the kids were seeing that payoff in those small groups or those working with those individuals. So shout out to them. And also, you know, I walked into music class right before break, and it is, you are on go. By the time you walk in, by the time you leave, you're constantly moving, singing, dancing, and they are loving it. So shout out to Mrs. Burnworth there. It's a lot of fun. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Knott. Mrs. Hahn.
Yes. How are you this evening?
Good.
Great. Well, I just wanted to kind of echo what the fairgrounds as well. As I was walking into some classrooms today, a common theme was definitely sharing, you know, fair stories and so forth. So teachers definitely took some time at the beginning or at the end of class just to have students raise their hands and share experiences from the fair, whether it was you know, what they ate, or, you know, what rides that they rode, or maybe what they showed for a project. But I thought it was awesome to take a step back from academics just for a few minutes and let the kids know why we take that week off of school and how important that is to all of our students and staff. We actually celebrated our Spirit Week the week before fair. We ended up Spirit Week on Friday with a pep rally to honor and recognize all of our fall athletes and the hard work that they put in. We all know that starts in the summer, and they work hard in and out of the classroom, putting in a lot of extra effort, you know, after hours in order to be in those athletics. And so just wanted to kind of give a shout out to those students. We have our Philadelphia and Gettysburg trip that will be leaving the parking lot this Thursday morning early at 5:30 a.m. We have 76 students in our 7th and 8th grade who will be going on that trip. Just a few of the highlights, they're going to be going to the Flight 93 Memorial. They'll be participating in Independence Hall, the Museum of the American Revolution. They'll also be doing a two-hour Gettysburg Battlefield Tour. This trip will be, they come back home on Saturday around 10:30 p.m. So it is a packed, you know, few days of just tons of things for them to experience, and it always proves to be such a great experience for these students. I know that they're getting out of the classroom for a couple of days, but what they're learning outside of the classroom is so valuable. They're seeing things that, you know, they'll never forget. So thank you very much for allowing that trip to take place. Just want to mention our student, as Mr. Dostadio had mentioned, a piece about the gifted education. Our teachers did participate in what we call WEP training, which is training that our teachers have to undergo to write written education plans. Those written education plans are individual plans for our gifted learners. And teachers who teach those content levels have to write those written education plans for the students. They talk in those plans about their learning styles, the students' interests, their academic strengths. They also set a year-long goal for the students so that that will stretch their learning. So these students are required to fulfill this written education plan that will stretch their learning to a little bit higher level than maybe what is going on in the normal classroom. Maybe that might be a project that they're conducting or some type of a research project or something like that. But the teachers have been working since our PD days in September to write these written education plans. We also have a new platform. They've also been learning that as well, which is called Same Goal. So there's a lot of really nice components on that. In years past, we've had to print off these written education plans, make copies of them, mail them out to parents, so you can see where I'm going with this. This new system that we have is all electronic. So teachers can work on it simultaneously, almost like a Google Doc where they can work on it together. And then those can be electronically signed by the teachers and everyone who participated in that. And then also those get emailed home to parents so that they can electronically sign as well. If we do have student or parents who don't have that capability, we can also, you know, mail them home that copy. But just wanted to share that with you, that the teacher's been working really hard on those written education plans over the last few weeks, and those will be going home out to parents at the end of next week. I just wanted to kind of update you a little bit on our PBIS. Next week on October 27th, I can't believe it, but it's already the last day of the first quarter. So we have our 2-hour late arrival where teachers will be working in their classrooms. So, you know, what other better day than to have kids wear their costumes to school that day? So, you know, we're having the kids wear costumes because, you know, middle school kids, they like to get dressed up too and participate in that. And we're also having our first fall dance that day. So we're going to have a very packed day that day. And November 3rd, we have an after-school activity for our 5th and 6th graders, and November 10th is our first Falcon Brunch. So, you know, just as, you know, we're all talking about different incentives and so forth that are going on in the school, you know, we had a PBIS meeting just this last week, and we went over our discipline records and so forth for the middle school, and our discipline is definitely down right now compared to what it was last year. So, we are seeing some really positive results from the things that we're doing. And then the last thing that I wanted to update you about was our 6th grade math position. Past Friday, a letter did go out to families of those 6th grade students, just updating them on the plan moving forward for this 6th grade math position. Over the last couple of weeks, we've communicated with different local universities. Mr. DeStadio kind of spearheading that and kind of taking charge to, he has some good communication and connections with those universities. We were able to get with a couple different people and then bring in some students for student teachers who are finishing up now currently in the field of teaching. And we have a individual, Ms. Devin Llewellyn, who is going to be taking over for us in that 6th grade math position. We're hoping here, like, the end of November. She came very, you know, high accolades to, you know, her teaching abilities and so forth. Mr. DeStadio and I were very, very impressed with her when we met with her last week. In the interim, Mrs. Stephanie King and Mrs. Amanda Barr will be teaching 6th grade math. They are, you know, you all know them. They're our instructional coaches. Very knowledgeable of the 6th grade content, the curriculum for math, so we couldn't have a better fit in the interim, I don't feel, moving forward. But we do have a long-term plan put in place, and I couldn't be happier with what we're, you know, having to move forward. So that's it.
All right.
Any questions?
No? Thank you very much. Mr. McPhail.
My presentation tonight is going to, I think I promised at the last board meeting that I was going to kind of give a more detailed overview of all the awards that our athletic program has accumulated this fall. And I'm going to do that, but there's no way that I can start without just mentioning the obvious. I mean, I sit here, you blink and you go from being one of the younger people in the room to one of the older people in the room, and you watch all of, you know, my colleagues and the students from the school come in, and you listen to everything that's happening in the school district, and we talk about it all the time. And I would just say, to me, I think we really need to, as a board, as an administrative team, as a teaching staff, you know, every single day we fight, scrap, coerce, motivate, negotiate to try to create an environment, study, to try to create an environment where our students can come as close to reaching their potential as you possibly can. And it's really prideful to be able to see that. Excuse me. So I want to talk about our athletic programs a little bit, and I am going to read this to you because there is so much detail here and so many accomplishments that I really want to make sure I hit them all. And again, I do not want to understate. The Buckeye Division of the Mid-State League, the schools in that league and everything, run a range from, you know, Taze Valley High School. I think they're pushing 1,300 students right now, 9 through 12. And, you know, we have our Fairfield County schools that have maintained. Bloom Carroll's getting bigger. My point is this. It is highly competitive in every single endeavor that you go into, and especially in athletics. In any given year, representation from the Buckeye Division for years and years and years has competed at the highest level in the state, in every single sport across the board. State championships in every major sport, representation in every major sport. So it's very competitive, which makes the accomplishments of our athletic programs this fall completely amazing. We've had some good years. I really don't know that, and I had no way to really go back to totally compare, but guys, this is really impressive. So I'll start. I'm going to review every sport and just kind of share with you what their record was, where they finished in the league. We're transitioning. This is a start of tournament week right now for the fall, so I just want to kind of bring everybody up to date. So we'll start with boys golf. Our boys golf team finished in third place in the Mid-State League, and Isaiah DeLong was the co-player of the year. Isaiah is a junior. You're going to hear a theme in this report. It's mostly underclassmen. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Isaiah was a junior. He was also the Mid-State League co-player of the year. You're also going to hear a theme that third place is the lowest finish that we have in any sport this fall. So boys golf. Girls golf, we only had two participants this year. We had four or five girls graduate last year. And so Lauren Mason and Kelsey Hawkins competed in girls golf. They were rookies, so they're getting their footing. They had a very good year, improved tremendously. I think we've got some depth coming next year. So we'll be back and have enough girls to compete for a league title. You've got to have five golfers to be able to be competing for a team component there. So in boys cross country, we were the team champions at the Mid-State League. We had the runner of the year in Drew Walton. Drew's a junior. We had the coach of the year in Coach Myers. Seems like he's got the market cornered on that award. It's every year. In the Mid-State League boys cross country event, we had the first, second, third, and fourth place finishers. We had the fifth place finisher as well.
Top five. Yeah.
So that's a perfect score in cross country. You can't do any better. So we had a perfect score at the Mid-State League tournament. We had the runner of the year, who was a junior. We had the coach of the year. So all league honors. Drew Walton, first team. Chris Rindle, who's a junior, first team. Nathan Phillips is a junior, first team. A.J. Ray is a sophomore, first team. Connor Runkle is a freshman, first team. Chase Miller is a sophomore, first team. Yep. Connor Myers, who's also a sophomore, second team. The entire team made first or second team all league. In girls cross country, we were the runner up. The runner of the year was Anna Conrad. Anna's a senior. Mid-state league, so first team was Anna Conrad, of course. Vera Henderly, who was a sophomore. And Adeline Winters, who's a junior. Second team, Abby Pike, who is a junior. Honorable mention, Claire Wilkinson is a junior, and Taylor Colopy is a senior. And boys soccer. Boys soccer record was 14-2-1 overall. They were 6-0-1 in the league. They were the Buckeye Division team champion. We had the player of the year in Caleb Reddy. Caleb is a senior. So in terms of Mid-State League awards, Caleb Redding, of course, was first team all-league. Aiden McCafferty, who's a senior, was first team all-league. Cole Rowley, who's a junior, was first team all-league. And you met Cole with the forestry team tonight, which is a common theme with our students at the high school. They do multiple things at a very high level. And then Caleb Smeltzer, who was a senior, was also first team all-league. Cohen Eihorn, who's a senior, was second team all-league. And Ethan Rooney, who's a senior, was second team all-league. Selah Alcorn, who's a sophomore, was honorable mention. And DJ Spicer, who is a senior, was honorable mention. In girls soccer, the overall team record was 14-1-2. The league was, we were 10-1-1 in the league. The girls soccer division, there aren't enough, they combined two divisions. All of the teams in the Buckeye and what used to be the Ohio combined to make up a division. So the girls were 10-1-1, finished third in the league behind a tie with Bloom Carroll and a loss to Taze Valley. So first team all league, Rachel Worthman, who's a junior, Katie McMahon, who's a junior, and Taylor Smeck, who's a sophomore, first team all league. Second team all league, Kyla Gosser is a freshman, and Peyton Hughes is a freshman. Honorable mention, Claire Brown, who's a junior, and Maddie Mitchell, who's a freshman. So every single one of those athletes will be back next year. In girls volleyball, overall team record was 17-4. The league record was 10-4. Those four losses came to two Buckeye Division teams. We finished third in the league. Now, the volleyball coach has asked that she's made a decision that she wants to hold her all-league selections. We have them. But she doesn't want to share those until we get into the tournament, which we completely understand and respect. And so that is our volleyball team. Again, they finished in third place in the league. So one of the things that happens in the Buckeye Division, there is an all-sports award. And that is just, you do the math on, you know, if you finish, there's eight teams this year. So if you finish in first place, you get 8 points. Second place, you get seven, and so on. So I don't know where we're at right now in terms of that, but we have to be in first or second place. I mean, because, you know, we won three, finished second in one, and finished third in two, if my math is correct on this. Lastly is football. Football season's not over. They have their last regular season game this Friday. Opportunity, we're 5-4 currently, got a chance to go 6-4. We're tied for third place with Taze Valley, which is who we play Friday night. That game does have slight playoff implications, however, it's football playoffs are based on first and second level points. So you get points for the teams you beat, and then you get points for the games that those teams that you beat win in the rest of their games. And so it's a strength of schedule thing for second level points. And so unfortunately, the math doesn't look like it's going to work out. We don't have a very high mathematical chance to make the playoffs, even if we win Friday night. However, it does give us an opportunity to have the first winning football season since, I think, 2017. I might be off by a year on that, but it's been a few years. So we're really excited about the growth of that program this year and the opportunities that they have. And incidentally, the football program is the same very young talent on that football team. The football all league meeting will be this Sunday, so we don't have the Mid-State League first, second, honorable mention all league. Just a couple of other items here of note in athletics for our community that may watch this. Just a reminder, Mr. Harris, our athletic director, wanted everybody to, if you don't follow us on Twitter, at AthleticsFUHS, he does a tremendous job, a really, really thorough and good job of getting information out via the athletic Twitter feed. So we would encourage everybody to, if you're not already on that, to jump on there. Also, our winter sports parent meeting is November the 8th at 6 p.m. That's in the auditorium. And he wanted me to share with the board that winter sports schedules will be posted by the end of this week. So we are in tournament week. Right now, as we speak, our girls are playing first round sectional tournament game against just a very unfortunate high school. Yeah, no, I'm so
we're up 2-0.
Nice. We're up 2-0. Okay. So we're playing Fairland High School in the first round of the sectional tournament over there right now at the high school. If we win that game, we'll travel to Uniodo on Wednesday evening for a match with Uniodo. Uniodo, let me check. I've got their record here. They're the number 2 seed in the district. However, they have 2 losses, and one of those 2 losses was to us. We just played them one time non-league. So we did see them earlier this year. But if we win, finish our business over there tonight, we'll travel to Uniodo on Wednesday. Boys soccer, of course, received a first round bye, so they'll play at the stadium, 6 p.m. Wednesday evening. Don't know the opponent yet, so that'll be a home sectional final. Girls likewise, first round bye. Their first round game would be Thursday evening, again here at home at 6 p.m. And then cross country travels to Rio Grande. The girls event starts at 1 p.m. this Saturday, and the boys run at 2. At Rio Grande. Depending on how we do at Rio Grande, the cross country regional is at Pick North High School a week from Saturday, and then of course the tournament schedules are on our website. If you go to our athletic website, and you can look out into the bracket and see when we play district semis next week. Most of those district venues haven't been announced yet, but the date and the time of the games have, so you can go on and look those up. Just a couple of other quick things, some dates and times of some things that we have coming up here. We do have, Mr. Gestadio mentioned, the fall ACT with writing. We'll be giving that tomorrow. Class meetings with Herf Jones. We have class meetings to discuss class rings, graduation attire. We have a promise to graduate, commit to graduate program we do with our freshmen. Each year at graduation, you see the sign that has all the signatures. That's the event that we have the students do that. So we appreciate our partnership with Herf Jones. That's coming up this Friday. We've mentioned our, in partnership with Nationwide Children's Hospital, our Signs of Suicide program. We do this with our sophomore group. All the preparation is ready, and next Monday and Tuesday, we'll be doing that presentation and doing those screenings and working with our sophomores and those students on Monday and Tuesday of next week. We have our staff PBIS breakfast. You recall in our AAA plus one reward process, staff members get points for various things that relate to student performance, student relationships, and support. And so if they accumulate 25 points or more, Mr. Schaefer and I are going to cater breakfast for them each quarter. So that'll be on October 27th, along with our National Honor Society hosts the costumes for caring. And that'll be during that school day. That's a 2-hour delay during the school day on Friday, October 27th. Our Marching Falcons in concert, one of my favorite things of the year, October 28th at 7 p.m. That's a Saturday evening. And our first quarter PBIS day for our students will be Friday, November 3rd. I want to end my presentation tonight with a shout out to our kitchen staff, Mrs. Morgan and her kitchen staff at the high school. What a tremendous group of women that they are. They do a great job with, if it's not easy to cook for, 500 students and make it taste good. And they really do a good job with that. But more importantly, they had a special meal today. It was a tour of Italy. It was delicious. It was really, really good. Special signs and posters, talk to the kids. They loved it. It was really good. So, I think that was something that we're going to be looking to do more and more. But more than any of that, if you watch our video announcements in the morning, we always have Miss Lisa does the menu for the day. The kids love it. they build relationships with our students. I mean, they're engaged. When those kids come in there for breakfast and they come in there for lunch, that entire kitchen area, super positive place for kids to be. They're reaching out to them, and it's just another group of people that are doing everything they can do to help our students have a good experience. So, you know, from the kitchen staff to of course our teachers and my colleagues, administrators. It's really, really proud to just have a seat at the table with this whole operation, and we're proud of where we're at. It's been a good fall.
Thank you. Thank you all for your reports. We appreciate it. All right. We will now move on to number 5, consent agenda section. 5.1 is the workshops and conferences. I think we've pretty much already talked about most of those. So then we'll move to 5.2, financial items. Mrs. Roberts.
If I flip over to our insurance report, both of our insurances for the month of September, our claims did come back down to be more in line with average. However, our year for both health and dental are higher than last year, but we did see a better than average, an average month. So it was really that month of August where we saw some high claims in both health insurance and dental that is really making our total year high. But overall, we had a decent month in September. Still sitting at positive cash balances. However, I do want to call out within our health insurance, so far for the year, so July, August, and September, we are only $23,000 to the positive. So really just kind of holding even of dollar in, dollar out. But we still have a healthy cash balance of $3.3 million. So we'd like to hover right around there. But, we're really dollar in, dollar out at this point. So really keeping our eye on health insurance.
Anybody? All right. Thank you very much. That was 5.3. Need a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Moved by Ms. Johns. Need a second?
I'll
second. Second by Mr. Hoffman. Mrs. Roberts?
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mr. Smeltzer?
Yes. Motion passes. Move into number 6, new business section. 6.1 is the motion to accept the resignation of Nick Claiborne as Rushville teacher effective October 1st. His last day of work was September 29th. Need a motion to approve. Moved by Mr. Hoffman. I will second. Mr. Roberts?
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mr. Smeltzer?
Yes.
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Motion passes. 6.2 is a motion to approve a 1-year support service contract for Alyssa Purvis as a 1-to-1 aide on salary schedule 1, step 3, beginning October 17th. Motion to approve?
So moved.
Mrs. Johns has motion. Need a second?
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Hoffman. Mrs. Roberts?
Mrs. Johns?
Yes, motion is approved. 6.3 is a supplemental personal service contracts of several individuals there. I don't know if anything, I point out that we do have a new head baseball coach now, Mr. Scott Burke, number one there on the list. And then the rest of the individuals are pretty much individuals that have...
All returning.
Yeah, all returning. Thank you. All right, need a motion to approve? Moved by Mr. Hoffman, need a second?
Second.
Mrs. John, seconded. Mrs. Roberts?
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mrs. John?
Yes.
Mr. Smallson?
Yes. We will skip over number 6.4 and go to 6.5. We have some volunteers listed there. Any questions, comments? If not, need a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by Ms. Johns. I will second. Mrs. Roberts?
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Mr. Smallson?
Yes.
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Motion's approved. 6.6, we have a substitute teacher list. Looks like a nice list there. Any questions, comments? If not, need a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Hoffman. I will second. Mrs. Roberts?
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mr. Smallson?
Yes.
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Motion's approved. And 6.7, we have a leave without pay for Zachary Turkowski on November 21st. Need a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by Mrs. Johns. Need a second?
Second
by Mr. Hoffman. Mrs. Roberts?
Mrs. Johns?
Yes.
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mr. Smallson?
Yes. Motion's approved. All right. That's it for new business. That'll move us into 7, which is executive session. And
No action
will be taken, but I need a motion to adjourn to executive session. Excuse me.
So
moved by Mr. Hoffman. I will second. Mrs. Roberts?
Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
Mr. Smallson?
Yes.
Mrs.
Johns? Yes.
Motion passes. We are in executive session at 8:27.